This session is presided over by my good friend, Professor Rohit Parikh. He is at Brooklyn College and the Graduate School of State University of New York. I have something to say by way of his introduction, but actually he does not need much introduction. There are many professors here, only one distinguished professor. Rohit, please have a seat. Rohit was born in India, but he went to Harvard University and all his degrees are from Harvard. He is three-time winner in the Putnam Mathematical Competition. He is currently Distinguished Professor of Computer Science at Brooklyn College and also affiliated with the Doctor Program in Philosophy, Mathematics and Computer Sciences at CUNY Graduate Center. He has published in journals in various fields, including the Transactions of the American Mathematical Society, Journal of Symbolic Logic, Philosophical Forum, Journal of Economic Theory, and the Journal of the Association for Computing Machinery. He is former chief editor of International Journal for Foundations of Computer Sciences and is the current managing editor of the Journal of Philosophical Logic. And it goes on, but if you are a distinguished professor, you don't need all this introduction. Rohit, it's all yours now.
Well, our first speaker is Professor Wali Mondal from the University of Redlands, right? And you got your degree from Ohio State, with which I have some familiarity. You spent some time in New Zealand and also in Bangladesh, right? Are you from Bangladesh, sir?
I'm from Bangladesh.
I see. So it's actually, I've heard about these loan programs, and one of my friends works, I think, for something called the Grameen Bank. So I'm particularly anxious to hear what Professor Mondal has to say. Thank you, Professor Mondal.
By way of introduction, I'm an economist. I teach economics at the University of Redlands now. And I was in Arkansas for 16 years after I got my PhD, and that was back from 1985 to 2000. And during most of my time in Arkansas, there was a governor who is now famous, President Clinton now. Somehow he was interested in the Grameen Bank. And you know, he knew that I was from Bangladesh, so one day he came to a conference and he told me that he had invited a sociologist, Risa Taub, I don't know if you know him, at Chicago University to try to replicate the Grameen Bank project in Arkansas, and he asked me if I would be working with him. So I was a young man, a professor coming from Bangladesh, just got my PhD, and the governor talks that way, and I said, yeah, sure, I was excited. So that's how I got interested, and I worked in that project for 3 or 4 years and published a couple of book chapters and a number of papers. The experiment was known as good faith fund. It didn't succeed, but I will come to that later. So now the introduction is this idea of collateral free group based lending has become very popular. As of today, there are 61 countries in the world which have adopted the model, the collateral-free group-based spending model called the Grameen Bank model now, which is kind of a misnomer, we'll come to that. There are approximately 7,000 microfinance institutes, which are basically banks but not banks, they deal with microcredit. And then there are over 30 million borrowers worldwide. In Bangladesh, about 25% of the households below the poverty level are members of the microcredit group-based lending program. And more importantly, and what is basically the focus of my talk today, more importantly, that group-based lending is now transforming into collateralized individual lending, which has given rise to what is known as micro-entrepreneurs. So that will be the other part of my talk today. Now, where did it all come from? I just published a book in year 2002. I worked on it for a number of years, and somehow or other, there was a fact, a big fact about microcredit, which was uninvestigated or people just kind of ignored it. And that is, this program actually started not with Grameen Bank, but way back in the beginning part of this century, in 1905. And of all people who introduced the model, it was Tagore, Rabindranath Tagore. Almost everyone in this room probably knows who Tagore is. He was a great poet, he won Nobel Prize, people know him by that. But he was a great reformer also. If people know a little bit of Rabindranath Tagore, they will know that he was a landlord. He inherited the landlordship from his family. And he had three jamindaris, or three landlords in Bengal, which is now, of course, Bangladesh. It was the province of Bengal in British India. In one of those places named Potishar, he went there and he found that people are desperately poor. They cannot pay the khazna or the rents on the land. So initially he started giving them some kind of loan. People would not repay it. And at that time it occurred to him that when he went to Europe at the age of 18, he had seen the cooperative societies. So being a reformer, being a thinker, he started thinking. And also, which will be of significant importance to this audience here, a sociological factor. At that time, in the beginning part of the 20th century, late 19th century, there were Hindu-Muslim tensions going on in undivided India. There were riots, and there were all kind of communal problems that were going on. So he thought about doing something about that too. So he introduced a model whereby he would lend money to poor people, and those poor people have to form a group. And the groups will be two Hindus, two Muslims, and one principal. Just think about that. He was very perceptive. They are equally divided between Hindu and Muslims, but the principal or the leader of the group will be the one who will be chosen by the group. So they can be Hindu, they can be Muslim. So that was his idea of uniting a community which was badly divided, which were fighting among themselves, burning each other's property and doing every possible thing that you can imagine doing of destroying the civilization and the culture. And then he also thought that these people may not have the means to give anything in collateral. So he told the group that what you need to do is one person will get a loan and the rest of the members will guarantee that. So if you are from that culture, you know that shame is the biggest factor of our life in that part of the world. If you borrow money, you have to return it, otherwise you will be ashamed. So the model worked. The model worked very well. Another interesting fact about the founding of Tagore's collateral free lending was a bank that he established in 1904. In a remote part of what is now Bangladesh, called Potishar. Now, he went there, and you cannot think of having something in a remote part of Bangladesh like a bank in 1904, but he established that, and for that he didn't have enough money. So he used a little bit of his own money, and the remaining money he borrowed from the sharks, the people who lend money at 200%, 300% rent. And then when he won the Nobel Prize in 1913, he invested a big part of his Nobel Prize in that bank. So that's how the bank worked for some time. Now, between 1905 and up until 1918, that Kaligram Krishi Bank in Potishar, in the remote part of Bangladesh, worked pretty well. But then after getting the Nobel Prize, he became busy. He started going to various conferences and he started going to international trips. And, you know, he sent one of his son, his first son, came for higher studies to University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. And his intention was that when he went back, he would take charge of the bank and the landlordship, which they did. But even after that, there was not enough attention paid. And the membership grew, so the bank became dormant. So between 1905 and 1974, there were some activities, but not enough. In 1974, that BRAC stands for Bangladesh Rural Advancement Council. It is one of the largest non-governmental organizations. In fact, according to BRAC's statistics, it is the single largest non-governmental organizations in the world. So they followed the same model, and they made the first loan after Tagore in a place called Salla in Sunamganj. Then after that, in 1976, there was an economist from Bangladesh, whose name is Yunus, he is now very famous. He founded, actually he started a project along the same lines, but he did not publicize any of the previous works of Tagore or Sunamganj or any of the loan projects. He started a project of giving money to poor people. Initially, the story is like this. One day, a number of women came to borrow money from him. He is relatively wealthy from Chittagong, and he didn't have enough money, so he asked them to go to a bank. So the women went to a bank, and the bank simply said, "We don't give money without collateral." And those women said, "We have nothing, not even any ornament that we can give you for collateral." So the professor went to the bank and asked the bank manager, "Can you give some money, keeping my property as collateral, because I'm Muhammad Yunus, I'm the head of the Department of Economics at Chittagong University, and I'm also a wealthy man." And the manager said, "No, sir, it doesn't work that way. People who borrow money, they have to have their own collateral." So that started, got him thinking, and then he asked the Ford Foundation for a project money to see if collateral-free lending works or not. Ford Foundation gave him some money, he experimented with this, and the project was successful. So in the process, he convinced the government that we can have an agricultural bank or a Grameen bank. Grameen means rural. Rural bank where desperately poor people can borrow money without collateral. And then it will be group-based. A group of five people start borrowing. One of them repay the loan. The other four start getting the loan. Or the first person who got the loan can a second loan, and so on. So that project became very successful. The reason why it was successful was it's in a country like Bangladesh, which is one of the poorest countries of the world. The poorer a country is, higher the rate of return on investment is. So the rate of return on any investment in Bangladesh right now is anywhere from 50% to 400%, four times the money you can get. Average rate of return is almost 200%. So you get twice as much. If you return a dollar, you get $2 in return. So it was a huge success. And following that, after the Grameen Bank became successful, in 1983, a number of NGOs, non-governmental organizations, they started their own, next slide, loan program. This is the slide of Tagore. The audience knows him, and of course he lived in the same time as I understand, okay? So in 1983, a number of those NGOs started their operation, and it just shot up like mushrooms. As of now, there are 601 MFIs, or microfinance institutes in Bangladesh, that are lending money. It's basically a system of credit delivery and savings mobilization scheme, specially designed to meet the unique financial requirements of the poor. It allows the recipients to improve the status of their living through access to additional capital without collateral. That has changed. Next slide, please. Okay. As I said, these are small loans, typically for working capital. And the second point over there, the second bullet point, is the important point, is informal appraisal of borrower's investment proposal. What it is like you go into rural, deep countryside, and then there are people who are shy, and Bangladesh is still under the parda system, which is women just cannot come out of their homes without the whole veil in the rural areas. In urban areas they can, but in rural areas most of the time they cannot do that. But if you move in a group, four or five people, no problem. So what happens is, the project works basically with workers who are dedicated people. And people who work as executives of those MFIs, they are also dedicated. It's a cause. It's more than just working for a business. So you go as trainers or executives of these programs and you select a number of villages. Before that, of course, all these people, they have to have a model, they have to have a plan, they have to have a mission. What is that they're going to invest their money in? And there are two types of MFIs or microfinance institutes. One are called maximalist, the other one is called minimalist. The maximalist one, actually, they do more than microfinancing. They go into countryside, they do adult schools and many other activities that are being performed there. It is a unique sociological experiment. Actually, there are some studies that I have seen recently. There have been tons of studies on Grameen Bank operations. One of them claimed that the adult literacy rate of Bangladesh today is so high because of the operation of microcredit. Because all these microcredit institutes will start night schools for adult education. So it is one of the greatest products of microfinance institute. Go ahead. This is a typical group meeting, and when I was working on this project, the date is not right. It was in 2001. That's me sitting there, and way back there in the behind, that's a lady from Ireland, the dedicated worker. She came to Bangladesh on a contract for 3 years. And this is how, this is a small group, and the gentleman in the middle there with the hat, with the suit on, he is the executive director of this program. And it was pretty chilly in the morning, but it's a small group. Yeah, groups can be 3 or 4 times as big as that. And then they will be talking about the loan programs and all that. So if you can see from the group, they are basically all women and desperately poor women. They are the borrowers. Go ahead. And this is an example of a loan. This is a cow that was bought for approximately 3,000 Bangladeshi taka, which was at that time about $60 or so. And by that time, the cow was fattened with some kind of oil cakes and indigenous fattening products. This cow was worth about 3 times as much. Go ahead. Next one. Okay. Now, this part of the presentation I'm doing here is what has been my focus, and I'm working on the second book. Hopefully it will be done this summer. And this is from microcredit to micro-entrepreneurship. As I alluded in the beginning, this microcredit program has created a class of people who are now micro-entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurship is the term that was first used in economics way back in the mercantilist era in the 17th century by Cantillon. And then it was defined and refined basically by Schumpeter. You probably heard the expression creative destruction, that is Schumpeter's term. You probably heard the expression a distinct sociological class, that was also Schumpeter's description. So he's the one, Schumpeter is the one who defined what entrepreneurship is. And what we see in a poor country like Bangladesh, by the way, Bangladesh is still no more than number 13 in ranks of poverty, one of the poorest countries of the world. Even in that country, microcredit has given way to the creation of a group with a very small amount of capital, which can be as small as $50. Who are not only self-supporting themselves, who are not only lifted themselves out of poverty, but who are employing significant number of people and who are showing what you can do with a small amount of money. So now, according to Schumpeter, an entrepreneur is one who is more than a capitalist. A capitalist doesn't take any risk with his or her money. An entrepreneur takes risk. And assuming risk always involves innovation. If you cannot innovate, you cannot assume risk. So if you adopt Schumpeter's model in the US, about 25% of the entrepreneurs are innovating a product at least during the first cycle of their production, Microsoft, Apple, or any other innovation you can think of. Next one, please. So now, the way Schumpeter gave his model was that an entrepreneur does significant changes to the production function. The production function is defined as a technological relationship between input and output. And there are, according to Schumpeter, there are five important interventions in the production function that lead to innovation. And these five are introduction of a new good, adoption of new inputs to produce a new good or the previously produced good, introduction of new technology, opening of a new market, or creating a new economic organization. This is a model that is used almost universally by anyone who is working on entrepreneurship. So what I thought of doing, and this was the first time I did that, and I got rave reviews from economists, was to adopt or extend this model to the case of micro-entrepreneurship. The term micro-entrepreneurship has been in existence since about 1970s, but no one has looked at it this way, no one has thought about introducing the term micro-entrepreneurship in a desperately poor country like Bangladesh, or country like Ethiopia for that matter, or country like Eastern Europe in Hungary or Albania. So doing that, what I did, I went back three or four times to Bangladesh and collected some information, and I tried to examine how many of these five factors of production function actually are there by these entrepreneurs who are innovating and who are leading to new production. Next slide, please. This is the heart of the model. Once again, innovation is at the center of the model, and then those are the five characteristics. Next, please. So now, what happened was, in Bangladesh, I'll just go very briefly over this. This is what I call old wine in new bottle. Once you have an entrepreneur class that is coming up, and once you have a market, the nature of the market is the market becomes oligopolistic. It's like a small fish eating a big fish. So in Bangladesh, the same thing happened. Out of 600 microfinance institutes, three became inordinately big. Those three are BRAC, ASHA, and PROSHIKA. These three NGOs controlled 80% of the microcredit market. Sure enough, they become entrepreneurial. Sure enough, they introduced a number of products. I'll tell you a couple of products that they introduced. One of them is called a neem toothbrush. It's like a tree called neem tree, which is always thought to be a very good tree brand for using brush. But then they introduced that toothbrush, and then it became a huge success. They used some toilet soap out of neem extract, which became a kind of cosmetic, a fashion statement in Bangladesh, things like that. So by doing that, they generated enormous profit and they deviated from the original model. It's no longer a mission-led institute, it's a for-profit institute. So once they did that, this is the model of oligopoly. The demand curve is a king demand curve. Interest rate was not determined in the market by demand and supply, but it's always at the king, which was as high as 17%. Now, 17% interest doesn't really matter for these poor people because the rate of investment is very high, the rate of return on investment is very high, but even then they are poor, you just do not need to trade on their blood. So the government become concerned. Next one, please. Government become concerned for two reasons. Now this is the other model here, before I go to the government. This is the Grameen Bank. The Grameen Bank is a little different from the other microfinance institutes in a sense that Grameen Bank is not an NGO. It's a regulated monopoly. 51% of the board of members of Grameen Bank are from government, 49% are Grameen Bank. Government does have some control. So what the Grameen Bank does, it peddles influence through loan programs, and you know, if you become big, you can always do that. If you have been to Dhaka, you will see that Grameen Bank has an 18-story high building. It's almost like an empire. And they are now branching out for more profitable investment like cellular phones, you know, like big loans for commercial vending like textiles and clothes. So they also charge a very high interest rate, and it's almost like 18%. Next one. Yeah.
You used an expression before, and I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch it. Mission-directed versus...
Mission-led.
Yeah.
Maximalist versus minimalist.
Two slides back, I didn't think you were doing what was mission-directed, the oligopoly.
Oligopoly.
Yeah. Being mission-directed to something else.
Okay. The original model of microcredit was mission-led. That means each microfinance institute have to have their own mission. It must be approved by the Bureau of Non-Governmental Organizations. So there are 600 microfinance institutes. The mission could be as simple as investing in pisciculture, raising fish, or poultry, or you know, cow fattening, and so on. So these are the smaller microfinance institutes. They go into a certain part of the country where they will find that kind of activities. Now, when these three large microfinance institutes became very big, they started buying smaller institutes. They started lending their own money to these other smaller institutes. So they will borrow their money and they will be influenced not by the mission but by the profit. And that's when the market become oligopolistic.
Thank you.
So comes the government now. How much time do I have? Okay. So the comes the government. When the government found that, well, the government was under tremendous pressure from the donor agencies. The donors are who? Donors are IDA, International Development Assistance of the World Bank. The donors are EU, the European Union. The donors are Canadian CEDA, Swedish CEDA, British ODM, the World Bank, and so on. So the donors thought that this is becoming market economy, which is good. At the same time, they are losing their very essence of the lending program. This is not for profit, this is for poor people. So they started putting pressure on the government that we are giving you money at 2%. IDA lends money at 0.75%, less than 1%, the International Development Assistance. And your people are re-lending this money at 18%? No, you cannot do that. So rumor has it that, you know, the World Bank Vice President went directly to the Prime Minister's office and kind of told her those things, and the Prime Minister was convinced. So then the government came for, this is one case as an economist where I support the government intervention. Because this is a case where it's a case for poor people. The market is okay, but you have to control the market when it needs to be controlled. It was a market failure, plain and simple. So comes the government, and the government, first of all, looked at the whole structure, the government's bureau for NGO affairs. They looked at the whole structure, and they thought the biggest problem was subcontracting or re-lending money by big organization to a small organization. So they corrected that by creating an organization called PKSF, which is Polli Kormok Samasthan Sahayak. And they said that they are the only one that will be lending money. So back to the mission-led model. And then once that happened, the economic structure of the whole organization, the microcredit lending institutes, changed. From oligopolistic, it became monopolistically competitive, which means that these are competition among few little organizations which have their own little market share. So they are competitive among themselves. There is almost free entry and free exit, but then the big organizations cannot peddle their influence. Next one. Now, this is my last part of my presentation, and this is where I have experimented with my idea of the micro-entrepreneurship. In 2001, when I went to Bangladesh, I saw the Women Entrepreneurs Association of Bangladesh selected 5 women entrepreneurs for their work on microcredit. And I talked with each of them, and these were published in all newspapers of Bangladesh, and Women WEA, the Women Entrepreneur Association of Bangladesh, is pretty well known. So I borrowed the five cases. I went to each of the five women, and with the idea of seeing if Schumpeter's model work or not. So in the following slides, what I have done is to see which of those five characteristics of Schumpeter's entrepreneurship model apply to them. Next one. Here's the case. This is a unique case. This is the first one I have here. It's a Minu Begum. It's a typical case in a country like Bangladesh, a male-dominated Muslim society, where men can leave women anytime they please to. In the countryside, there is no record of marriage and divorce. So this woman, Minu Begum, was deserted, not even divorced, by her husband at the age of 19 or 20. She did not know where he was, and she was left in the dark. The only thing that she got from her ex-husband was a drive, an entrepreneurial drive. Her husband was a little businessman, but one day he found another woman, he left, and she does not know where he is. So then she borrowed some money from the Grameen Bank. She joined a group, she heard of Grameen Bank, joined a group and told the group that I'm going to do something which is going to be a very courageous, daunting thing in a countryside in Bangladesh. And the other members heard and she said, I'm going to have a tea stall. I will run the tea stall. She was a pretty woman at the age of 19, attractive woman, and running a tea stall in a rural countryside in Bangladesh. And then she also said, I'm going to design it in a very pretty design so that people get attracted. And then most importantly, instead of serving tea and latte biscuit, which is something like a cookie, which is like latte, it's a tall cookie, which goes with a cup of tea, she said, I'm going to start serving bhapa pita, which is a rice product, which is as big as like a big muffin, but basically all rice and very filly. So somehow that attracted the attention of the trainers. And this is a good combination, let's see how it works. They started doing that. And there was a lot of support for her, although in a rural countryside, she could have been harassed, she could have been under pressure to do nothing but all of those things. And then she succeeded. So what we have here is the combination. What we have here, the drive for marketing. What we have here, changing the production function in a nutshell. In about 3 years' time, she started with 3,000 taka. She had 10 of those tea stalls in surrounding villages, run by her nephews, nieces, relatives, and who have you. She had 25 cows. She had 3 ponds, and she had some acres of land. So her net worth was almost 7 lakhs of 700,000 taka. So that's what the success story is. The next one. This is Majeda Khatun. Now, if you look at the very right-hand side, a variety store in her neighbor. Variety store is almost like Schumpeter would call it capitalism, right? It's just having a mom and pop store and no risk. But then if you look below, used inexpensive labor to assist in the sales of variety of high demanded goods. So she created a market for it. It's a variety store, all right, but she was not retailing. She created her own product. So that's innovation. That's introduction of a new good, creation of a new market, going for new raw materials and adding to it and doing another product for it. So if you go down below, she was a very successful entrepreneur with that. So basically the idea is, what will sell here? What can I do? What's the raw material coming from? Okay, next one please. This is another great story, Dr. Sandhya Rai. She is a medical doctor with an MBBS degree, and she was working for one of the NGOs in Bangladesh, Ganashastra Kendo, and that's when she learned of nutritional supplement, and she created her own nutritional supplement for the rural population. She started doing that in the least expensive possible way. And she combined nutrition training, nutritional supplement and skills, education to create a new type of NGO and more effectively combat malnutrition. So once again, this is a case of an entrepreneur who left a very comfortable life of being a doctor, started caring for the rural population, and came up with a product mostly for the pregnant and nursing women, and became a huge success. Next one, please. Now, this is an environmentally successful story. Dil Roshan Akhtari introduced a new type of dry flowers and floral arrangements just to be conscious of the nutrition. And when I talked to her, I asked her why dry flowers in a country like Bangladesh, when flowers are so inexpensive and labor is so inexpensive, you could have made tons of money with fresh flowers and labor. She smiled and smiled. She said, well, you just look at the flower shop next to you. They are dumped. The streets are polluted. Nobody comes and clean them. So literally, there are few hundred thousand pounds of, you know, stuff that are sitting there. Nobody cleans them, and the rain comes and it becomes a mess. So I thought I don't need to do that. And also I can cater to the urban population, relatively wealthy ones, and not pollute the environment. So once again, it's a new product, a new way of doing things. Next one. And this is another story, which is once again innovation of thrifty, colorful shades which are non-pollutant and economically friendly. So the last two women, they were both concerned of the environment, but they created new means of new production. Go ahead. And then here is one which is distributorship for farm-grown poultry products. So the poultry, well, this is one of the earliest poultry farms in Bangladesh. Right now poultry is big in Bangladesh, but she is the early bird, early riser, and that's where she got her profit from. Okay, next one. Conclusion. Microcredit program started in 1905. Grameen Bank popularized the operation. All microcredit programs are targeted for the poor, mostly for the women. And by the way, I guess most of you know that the recovery rate of microcredit loan is 98%. Whereas in Bangladesh, the recovery rate for conventional loan is no more than 63%. 37% of the loans are not repaid. Then innovation is a part of microcredit operation that's promoting economic development. There are over 1,200 NGOs, only 50% of them engage in mission-led microcredit operations. Recently, government started to control the microcredit operation. Next one. Policy implication. It's a tool of poverty alleviation. It used to be, and then it deviated. The government came back and rescued it. Microcredit generates significant positive externalities, such as the empowerment of women. And microcredit program helps develop infrastructure and rural development. Recommendation, increase the scope of microcredit to reach all families below the poverty line. Right now it's 25%, but it can be done in a country like Bangladesh. Develop micro enterprises and micro entrepreneurs, which is happening now. Ensure the success of a small microfinance institutes, and continue empowerment of the poor and particularly women. Next one. What's next for Bangladesh? An in-depth analysis of socioeconomic aspects of microcredit and poverty alleviation, which is yet to be done. An analysis of the microcredit models adopted by other countries. Thank you very much.
May I assume from your last slide that an assessment has yet to be made of the point at which this kind of microcredit becomes sufficiently important to the overall economy as opposed to society? I don't quite know where it's going to tip over to something which can possibly be done over.
Any other question?
Not what I think it is, but I follow that.
First of all, I have to tell you one thing is that economists
there is one agreement among economists about the impact and the importance of microcredit in a country like Bangladesh. Last year alone, there were 3 Nobel laureates in economics that visited Bangladesh, including Professor Sen, Professor Stiglitz, and Mulligan, 3 of them. All 3 of them were very impressed, and all 3 of them suggested that the government needed to increase the scope of microcredit. It's a great tool for poverty alleviation. Unfortunately, if you're familiar with subcontinent, especially Bangladesh and Pakistan, politics plays havoc there. What is happening right now, and I'm blunt about it, we have a government which is a little bit non-market and which is extremely corrupt. So there are some minor problems with the microcredit operation. There are 1 or 2 microcredit institutes that were promoting Christianity side by side in other educations and all that. And the government took that very hard on them, and they are punishing the whole microcredit operation for that. So to answer your question, the microcredit operation can be a significant tool for poverty alleviation. It has already proved to be a significant tool for improving such things as learning, such things as rural infrastructure, and many other serious problems.
How does it change?
It does change, absolutely. Thank you again.
Remedies when you have a problem like you have in Bangladesh and unempowered women and poverty and so forth, and you develop this microcredit system, which really sounded great. And I wanted to say that with when the early Chinese came to the United States, they couldn't go to the banks, they didn't have money, they were poor, and so people developed a system of a cooperation called credit systems, where a group of people would pool their money, and then one borrow the money, and then the next month or so, the next one would, of course you'd have to pay back, then the next month they would let the next person borrow the money. And again, it was not based on any rules or banking system, but on the honesty and integrity of the members involved, and shame was also a very important part of it, because if you didn't pay back, you know, your whole standing in, among your own people would be ruined. So this is what we mean by remedies, and this, I'm a great one for saying, you have a problem, you got to come up with a remedy.
Right. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, our next speaker is Parmar from Green College. He's a professor of film, but he says that he's also a lawyer because he has 7 years ago. And he's going to show a short film, and then I assume we'll ask questions.
Certainly. I just want to give a little bit of an introduction to this film. It's about 19 minutes long, 19 minutes and 10 seconds. And this film is a sort of a documentary that was prepared by me. When I went to India from December 20th through January 2016, that was January 16th of 2003-2004. And this film was shown at a conference in which I was invited to speak, and it was in response to the purpose of my calling there, which was to talk about the role of media in the tannery and textile business. How many of you, by the way, just give a hand, please. How many of you are wearing some leather shoes? Leather shoes? Okay, leather belt, leather wallet. Guess where it's coming from? It's coming from one part of the world. That's Asia. They're supplying everything. And we're talking about globalization, and all the jobs being sucked out,
well, the job began to get sucked out from the United States and from Europe back in the 50s. It's not a new phenomenon. And the reason is because we have environmental laws here that are actually enforced. There are no environmental laws that are enforced. They actually have more environmental laws in that part of the world than we do here. But the problem, really, is, of course, we know the problem is lack of implementation. So that's why this video was made. It's in response to certain issues that we'll see. And of course, there's a stigma that there's so many terrible things wrong with all the, what's called, the backward society of a developing country. Well, while we do recognize that the developing countries are providing such valuable resources to the Western countries, we must also recognize that certain things need to change to make life better. Why did I make this thing? Two reasons. People are dying, and there's a case of international dumping, environmental dumping. This piece is a work in progress, and I'm going back in that region, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and India. Hopefully I can get into China. Not very likely, at least for 2004, to continue making this documentary. And I'd rather have you watch it than I can have, talk a little bit about it. One quick thing, by the way, so that you know, by the way, since I've made this particular thing for people that are part of the industry, businesses, representatives from all the sort of countries who know the industry so well because they've been living it for at least 20 years, that I need to tell you a little bit about what happens. Leather companies and textile companies and dye companies create chemical effluents. These chemical effluents then get leaked into the ocean, the river, local water. They get released in the air. Okay? And because of recent legislation in India and other areas like in Pakistan and Bangladesh, these chemical effluents must go through sort of a pipeline, what's called common effluent treatment plants, where companies are required to, by law, remanufacture or recycle some of these chemicals. We're talking about cadmium, chromium, lead, all sorts of harmful elements that cause us cancer, causes stomach ulcers, skin disease, all sorts of stuff, all sorts of terrible things. Genetic defects, birth defects, all sorts of nasty things. And so these chemical treatment plants are supposed to extract these chemicals and then find a place to then dump them. Okay? Life is not perfect. This all is good in theory. And of course, what happens is, you'll see in the video, and then we can talk about that. But I just wanted to know what common treatment effluent plants are all about.
Environment, we say, is when we talk of environmental disaster, we know that we are talking of an unforeseen disaster. But when we talk of environmental health, we are talking of an immediate consequence. So when we show them the health consequences of what the environmental neglect has led to, is the adverse health effect. All the media persons can make sense of they can easily correlate. So we are looking at the issue of, that's why we are looking at the issue of occupational hazards and environmental hazards as one and the same. And also we feel that environment and health are not two compartments, environmental health, both are very clearly linked. And even for media to understand the environment, this relation has to be made quite manifest for them to grasp the issue. Actually, the issue of toxicity is the issue of food chain poisoning as well. So what we are looking at is the not the immediate consequences, which may not be visible, which may not be manifest. We are looking at how it is going to enter our food chain. And once the toxins enter the food chain, then it is beyond repair.
The lack of health impact studies has been a big detriment to environmental conservation in India. Look at the case of asbestos. You know, one of the largest payments made by industry in the US after tobacco has no contribution in India, because we have no cancer registry, we have no asbestos mesothelioma registry. Nobody knows whether a migrant worker or a worker who's worked for 30 years, when he goes out and gets some disease which could be asbestosis 10 years, 15 years. There's no tracking, no record of that. Also, it often gets diagnosed with tuberculosis. So if doctors, medical professionals, it's not diagnosed as occupational hazard disease, but of tuberculosis, which has no compensation attached to it. And finally, the way we have never really kicked in the tort law in India for compensation. So compensation, accountability for compensation has never really taken off in India. The case law has never been developed.
Where do they take baths? Both India, I've suggested. So the problem is there. They take the baths in river, ponds and dugout. And all these are highly contaminated. I've asked about deterioration and disinfection of this water in that area. They put the bleaching powder in the well. They say once in a year. But most of the wells have been dried up. Most of the surface water has been dried up. So now dependent on the surface water, the river water, which is highly contaminated, it's flowing, natural flow, because all the wells have got dried up. So they have no option. So they can't make their own well because they will not get the water. Only rainy season they can get the water. After rainy season, again it's sober. So they're more dependent on the surface water, which is flowing, which is highly contaminated. So these are the adverse effects.
These buffaloes and cows, they are aborting abnormally these things. So these are the effects which can be physically identified. And after that, when we conducted a test from NBRI, they have indicated that chromium is there everywhere, each and everything chromium is there. And besides skin disease, because these are the farmers, mostly 90% they are the farmers. So they are working in the fields. So most of the time they have to stand in this effluent, or you can say the chrome laden effluent, irrigating the fields and all these things. So they are less, these nails have gone fortunately absolutely dead. And their feet and all, they have lot of boils, rashes. So it takes years and years for them to heal these things.
इसका नाम ये हुआ हरा भरा मुर्गी के खाने में भी लगता है ये मुर्गी का खाने में लगता है आपको आलू का चाट में लगता है जैसा कि चाय बागान में लगता ये हरा भरा हर गाछ के लिए ये फायदेमंद है जैसा कि ये चमड़ा ये चमड़ा में सब में रोहा रहता है अब इसको साफ करने के लिए हमको सोडियम देना पड़ता है और उसमें पूरा भी आपको सोडियम मिलेगा सोडियम चूना देने के बाद में ये चमड़ा आपको भी गिरेगा इसका जो गैस है अब थोड़ा इसको गैस भेज दीजिए समझ में आ जाएगा झिल्ली ये झिल्ली कारखाना से लोग ला करके इसको सुखाते हैं सुखाने के बाद में बहुत ऐसा सुखाते नहीं है इसको डायरेक्ट तालाब में फेंक देते हैं फेंकने के बाद में ये मछली आपको डायरेक्ट मछली खा लेता है खाने के बाद में बहुत ऐसा इससे बीमारी भी हो सकता है अब इसमें देखिए इसमें सोडियम है चूना है इसका कुछ धुलाई नहीं होगा इसी तरह इसको मछली को खिलाया जा रहा है इससे बीमारी बढ़ेगा कमेगा नहीं आप
If suppose, take only the small example, 500 is there and they have a common treatment plant, CET. And one unit is producing 100 meter cube per day effluent and simultaneously 5. So 500 meter cube per day they are producing the effluent. The treatment plant is below than this capacity. Naturally, it is not functioning. And if I am producing 100 meter cube per day effluent, but I am sending only 50 meter cube per day effluent to the CET. And the rest of the effluent I throw somewhere else because it is expensive. And even I am not giving fat information to the state government to save the income tax, sales tax, custom. So I am producing the 50 metric ton per day, but I am showing to the state government to pay only 12 or 12 something like that, and to save the electricity, water, and other many aspects. So that is why the function is not there.
Okay, you can see this drain. It is treated, so-called treated effluent from the treatment plant. Basically, it is supposed to go to irrigation. For irrigation, this air, but there are certain norms it should meet before reaching the fields. So neither it is meeting the norms, and secondly thing is that this water should not reach Ganga also. So you can see directly from my passing. Evening time, mostly in the evening time, when there is nobody to check all the things, they open all the system and they let it go directly to the Ganga. So several times because of this water. It had reduced the dissolved oxygen of the river to so much extent that thousands and thousands of fish have died just on these areas of Shekhpur and CUNY village. This is the effluent from the Tannery mixed with domestic sewage from the local dwellings across this area. So, you can see the color of the effluent is also green and beside there is a foam all over. This foam and the color, green color is because of the chrome content, while this foam is because of the various salts, dyes and syntax and other chemicals are used in the tanning process in the industry. It's because of this. And it reaches Ganga, so all these things, it reduces the DO level of the river, which can result in a huge fish dying. This is my factory. This is a chemical industry. It's owned by me. And we manufacture our textile, dye, and their intermediates. We have effluent, water effluent. We have storage waste. We have air pollution, all these problems we are facing, and we are solving it. Technically, we have got to solve all these problems. We have got the water effluent treatment plant. Here what we do is a primary treatment. Only primary treatment we remove the solid and we remove, adjust the pH 7. These two things we do here. All other treatments, COD, BOD, etc. It is being done at the next step with our jointly treated AETB plant here. All the water from all factories, they collected that and it is being treated collectively. And again, from there, the water goes to the municipality sewer system. And then it is mixed with the city sewer water and it is that treatment is for tertiary treatment. Thereafter only this water can be drained in the river or sewer.
In case of tanneries, we had to know that there are around 350 tanneries in Kanpur. There are out of which around 210 are chrome-based tanning, and remaining are vegetable tanning units. As far as chrome tanning units are concerned, then they are apart from the primary treatment that they are supposed to have at the industry level, and there is a common effluent treatment plant for treating the effluent subsequently. Apart from this, chrome tanning, chrome recovery plants are required at the individual tannery level, or for that purpose we have been persuading, pressurizing, and through district administration also many times we try to get these implemented. Right now around 87-88 industries have already installed a chrome recovery plant. For the small scale industries which cannot afford individual chrome recovery plants, we have tied up a Central Research Institute Chennai. We have got a feasibility report prepared, and we are working on providing a common chrome recovery plant for them. For some assistance will be provided by central government, and some will be also municipal corporation, and balance will have to be paid by the tanneries themselves. So we are continuously keeping a track and trying to help them putting up these plants.
In this complete west zone, you will not find any common effluent treatment plant which takes complete composite purely influent from industries running so perfectly. It's just our plant, the common effluent treatment plant or whatever. We are running it so perfectly. It's just because of the coordination of the collecting department, the accounts department, the maintenance department, the laboratory department, the R&D department, to unite together as a team.
This factory is spending before 22 years. We are working here vegetable tannery. Vegetable tannery, there is nothing hazardous. We are working with our own material. Say, balabulam, have you seen this nut, balabulam and bubble bar?
My tannery is vegetable tanning unit, and our raw material is this marabulum nuts. These nuts, these are forest products. This grows in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. And this is forest product, and this marabulum nut is also used for digestive powder. This is also used in eating. And this bubble bath, this is used in tanning the leather. First, this crushed marabulum and crushed bubble bath is put in leech yard. And there, from there, tanning liquor is extracted from this marabulum nuts and bubble bark chip. And from that extracted liquor, leather is tanned, raw leather is
being polluted. black. It should be white when it is bigger, transparent when it is becoming black. So there was something in my heart that I have to, being a part of my country, being a human being, I have to do something. And this is, the credit goes to my principal and Mr. Oveas, so who gave me chance to visit that workshop at St. Mary's. And from that, it was our first step. And from that, our journey began.
Things are changing. And these things change. Takes a lot of things, years and years, but the moment when they pick up, they will just move like anything. I know that. You see, like slowly, these villagers, now they know the terms chromium, they know the tannery effluent, they know the water can have such kinds of chemicals, they know now that the groundwater can be polluted, they know that crops can be polluted, they know that the skin injuries can be because of these problems. They are educated. So now nobody can fool them, you know, for the future. And now they are conscious. They can, where the problems are increasing, they know how to approach, whom to approach, where to go, what to do.
Simply put, it's a very straightforward thing. There are rules, there are regulations, and there are people who are violating them. The awareness that these need to be complied, and that there is a process by which this compliance can be forced, is evident by many different types of action across the world. The whole exercise is basically to try and find the right kind of mix of these actions to get things right and make communities safe and make our environment safer to live in. That's the long and short of it, how we do it.
The important thing is it's so possible to do. That's the crux of it. That we're not saying that it's not something which we can reinvent. You just need the will to do it. And it's possible. Technologically it's possible to do. As a system it's possible to do. You can replace chemicals within your production system. You can minimize the toxicity. You can contain whatever cannot be minimized. And you can safely contain it. To whatever depth. So you can create these barriers to the extent possible.
And I wonder about the workers. I mean, first of all, they're exposed to all their toxicity. Are some of these workers, are they in trade unions? Do they have any study besides these NGOs, these environmental leaders, who are doing anything on their behalf? Are there any parts of the government that in any way are looking into that kind of risk to these workers in these industries?
That's a great question. Part of the conference that I attended there certainly addressed that. In fact, it was a three-day conference and one whole day was addressed to talk about workers and their conditions and health issues. We have what's called OSHA here. There they have no such government body, either in India or Bangladesh or Pakistan or Sri Lanka or Nepal, Bhutan, nor in China. They don't have a place or a forum on which to address their own health concerns. Give you an example. One of the dye factory owner took me aside after I'd gone to his factory, and he said he would not be willing to get recorded to admit to the fact that he said this: look, I'm hiring you to work in my factory at 10 rupees a day. The moment you get sick, the moment you can't work because you've been injured in my factory, fine, I'll fire you. Then I'll hire your brother for the same amount of money. And it's that degree of viciousness that has pervaded the entire industry in the tannery, textile, and dye factories. There's no consideration whatsoever for the relationship between the factory worker and the owner is just not sort of conducive to have even sort of a union. One of the interviews that I didn't show in this thing was a discussion by a union representative that I was able to luckily catch on the street. And he talked about this very issue. The collusion between government officers and the owners themselves in investing in building safer factories doesn't take into account worker health issues. For example, first aid kits. Simple things like having a washroom, wearing gloves, having appropriate gear to walk into the factory, and to know that these are the things that you can use to protect oneself. That awareness isn't there, and that awareness is not imparted by the owners to the workers themselves. So the NGOs, of course, are working to remedy that. There are laws in place, of course, like I said, to promote, but nothing compels, because there's no implementing force to compel the workers, the owners to then follow through the law. I hope I answered that question.
Did you encounter the sort of the argument that one frequently hears on this side of the water, that from countries like that, yes, the few Western devils, you know, Western Euro-American industrialists went to improve your own land for years. And we know this is true. The Hudson River is much cleaner now than it ever was in the 19th and most of the 20th century. The cholera pond became so polluted that it rained and all that jazz by the time of the revolution. And they're saying that the argument one hears is, of course, this is part of the process of industrializing. One hears that from the Chinese, one hears that from various other South Asian sources. Were you hearing that argument as well in your research on site, as it were?
Certainly. It's been brought up. And in fact, there are two strains of thought. There's the one thought is, and within the industry themselves, okay, within the government bodies that are trying to promote sort of a hand-holding and a gaining of confidence between this relationship that's trying to be built between the government on one hand and to implement the law in a sort of a, don't worry, I'll take care of you as the industrialist if you take care of me type of method. And the government is saying that, you know, if you show this type of documentary to people within our country, you will cause a lot of stir up because you're showing something that's not good for the people. We need to build our businesses. We need to do what we can first to aggrandize, to build an infrastructure, to become rich, and then maybe we can then attend to all the other issues that would come about as a result of having been industrialized. Certainly they agree to that issue. The other sort of point of the argument by the workers themselves is that, hey, wait a minute. By the time, you know, by the time you guys get rich on our health and destroy our environment, it'll be too late. Because statistically, the kind of damage that's being done now to the water, to the ground, to the air, will be so great that their grandchildren will have birth defects and genetic mutations as a result of chromium 6. For example, things that happen that I have yet to document is that, see, chromium 6, by the way, is used in the leather tanning process in the factories. It's not used in the vegetable tanning process. So, chromium 6, by the way, how many people saw Aaron Brockovich, that film? Where what happened as a result of that film was, through arbitration, the company that Aaron Brockovich was, you know, trying to sue or whatever, they settled for $333 million. And there was still no determination as to whether or not chromium 6 was contributing to the health and environmental problems for that community. Well, here you have chromium 6 all over the place, as you saw in some of the footage. Chromium 6 takes the water and makes it green. That's not algae that you saw. So a lot of the women that go after the community and want to buy cheap wood to cook, what they'll do is they say, hey, look at those pieces of scrap leather that are laying around that no one's bothering with. Well, you know what, I can use that and use that to heat up my food for our family because it doesn't cost me anything. Take the leather, that contains the chromium. That's usually trivalent chromium, which is chromium 3. When you heat trivalent chromium, it turns into chromium 6. And then when you heat chromium 6, and these leather ashes then get inhaled, and that causes lung cancer. And that happens all throughout the community. And that's predominantly the method of cooking in Bangladesh. And of course, there's no education to let them know that this is not good for them. So to answer your question, it's such a huge, there's so many issues.
But then this raises the second question, doesn't it? What's the cost to convert a larger percentage, put aside the dyeing of a leather tanning? You're saying the vegetable tanning doesn't produce this cost. This vegetable tanning is very nice leather with fewer pollutants. What's the cost to convert it? What's the cost per unit of leather? It's a high leather. Are they comparable price and is the conversion feasible?
No, it's feasible to go through a chemical process, which is a 16-step process, which takes where you can take leather once it's cut and process it within a week. And you can process a ton of leather in a week. And vegetable tanning is a lot slower process. It's a 45-day process. And of course, you're manufacturing about a fraction of what you would normally do. So, in terms of the cost effectiveness, it's a lot easier to manufacture in bulk using a chemical process. But then, of course, we know what sort of health and environmental impact occurs, and there's no one really to contain that cost.
What kind of coalition do you have there in terms of, say,
picking
this up as an issue?
Well, one would think that the democratic process would work. The gentleman that had talked about the leak of chemical effluents into the water was instrumental in written a book on public hearings where public hearings are instituted or called upon by locals. The problem is the locals don't speak the language, and the democratic process then fails. For example, I'm just telling you about the problems, but I'm not telling you the solution because I know it's so important. But what happens is, if I don't speak the language, and I don't know what my rights are, then I can't reach out to the people like the NGOs who really know what's going on. The NGOs then reach out to me and come out to the community to me and say, aha, I see what problem you're suffering from. This is what we can do to help out. And the NGOs have been really instrumental in doing that, to bridging the gap and creating a better, more democratic process. For example, the judges who are in charge of administering the and holding the hearings, don't know what's going on. In fact, they have actually said, you know what, you tribal person, now that you've called on this public hearing to talk about the fluoride that's in your water which is causing your gallstones, okay, I don't know what is causing your gallstones. So what I want you to do is, I'll give you a week, form a committee of experts, of scientific, of five or six scientific experts, and then report back about the impact of fluoride in your water, because I don't know whether or not your ailment is due to this chemical that's being produced by this industry next door to you. And so even the judges are not aware of the fact that the tribal person doesn't even know what pollution is all about, doesn't even know what fluoride is, doesn't even know who the NGO would be in charge of trying to get them to voice the issue. So this is a whole mess of issues. But the only coalition that is sort of in charge is what's called the Central Pollution Control Board. And they are there to monitor all these issues. The way the structure runs, at least in India, which is a lot different than many of the other countries, where there is no infrastructure, there is no pollution control board, is that in India, at least, you have four zones, the north, south, east, west zone. So you have, and that interview that you saw was the north zone chief. And lucky to get the interview, you know how hard it is to get interviews at all in India, especially in the government, all the bureaucracy in India. But they administer, they have all the rights to administer all this stuff. But the problem is, at least there, is you have the state control board that has to implement all the laws that the central control board designs. The state control board doesn't necessarily implement it because they're dealing with sovereign issues. The state doesn't want to get federal or central government intervention. So it's a whole mess of political issues that can come into play when the state control board has friends and family that are part of the industry. So corruption is, of course, comes into play.
Can you tell me why the tannery industry is such a dominant industry in India, especially when the cow is so sacred that they don't slaughter it? How did that come about?
Actually 50% of all the leather that is produced in the world is from China. And about 30 to 45%, I'm not really sure of the numbers, so please don't quote me on it. But up to about 40% to 45% of all the leather that's coming out of the world is produced in the SAARC countries, in the SAARC region. 30%, I think, is coming from India. Even the tannery leather people who are working in this industry are saying, look, it's a business proposition, essentially. They're saying leather is gotten from cows that are, or pigs that are slaughtered for the meat. The leather is not necessarily sought for, and animals are not necessarily killed for the leather itself. Leather is a byproduct. And therefore, it's okay for us to be involved in this business because, you know, we're not necessarily trying to kill the cow. We're just trying to make a business out of whatever else is there. Does that make sense to you? Not really. It doesn't make sense to me. But that's how they reason it out.
Let's make this the last question.
Okay. There are a lot of U.S. companies who are having their subsidiaries based in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. So what is the level of compensation in case of there's an accident over there? So are they compensated the same way or the different way?
In what industry?
Like behavior, the mobile incident in India, the compensation was not automatic to what they were compensated in the United States. So do you find something same case of textile factories or a different thing? What was your operation in regard?
I'm not sure if I'm qualified to answer that question, but I do want to touch upon some things that I know about it. First is that because of the currency issues, it's a lot easier for a corporation from here to pay out, and because of the way the currency runs and the money that's distributed, it's easy to pay out here and for the money to get out to be reached out to the community. The problem is, does it really get to the community? Even in Bhopal incident, the money never really got to the community. Many of the people who actually are holding on to the money still are politicians. So because of that mess, it doesn't really work out as a solution unless you actually have an independent body that does distribute it, which is so hard to oversee.